Good afternoon, everybody. I'm happy to be the first presenter. At least you're all well fed, so I hope you're in a good mood. So my topic is kind of a follow-up to a talk that was not here. But I held a talk some while ago about how we implemented RPKA on our router platform, and I thought it would be interesting for a wider audience what we learned a year after we basically armed our system and dropped invalid routes with our RPKA system. I will go over the basics first a bit for people who are not, who don't know what RPKA is or don't really know how it works. I like to think of it kind of BGP. You have kind of two directions. You have an outgoing RPKI, which means you can sign your routes. This basically means you, here in Europe, you go to the RIPE NCC, and you can click on a button, and then your route will be signed cryptographically, which basically means you're binding your prefix to your origin AS, and you're also specifying a maximum length of the prefix, meaning that if, for example, you have a /16, if I would put in max length /16, nobody would be allowed to announce something with a bigger sitter, like /24 in this case. Why we didn't do that there, I will explain later. But basically, that's like a one or two step process. You log in, you click, RIPE NCC will check if your current BGP announcement actually is valid. And then you are good to go with outgoing RPKI. The other direction would be incoming RPKI, meaning you can use RPKI to filter invalid routes on your routers. And that's basically the great thing about it. For that to happen, you need a few more building blocks. First, you need an RPKI validator software. The software will validate the signatures on the ROAs, on the route authorization objects. That is done separately offline from your router, which is a good thing because most routers have the CPU of a calculator. And after that, the result of that validation is transferred via a special protocol to the router. That was, in the past, mostly done via plain text. Nowadays, you can also switch it to encrypted transmission to the router. And then, if that result of the RPK validation is available to your router can then make routing decisions on it. So, as far as I know, no vendor does that automatically. You have to define some sort of routing policy to activate it on your router. So, what did we do? First step, log into your LIR portal and sign your routes. If you're an end user, no problem. Your sponsoring LIR can do this for you. They just have to log in and click a button. So if you're an end user, don't worry. Just go to your LIR and tell them to sign your routes. After that, you get a nice dashboard where you can see all your announcements and if you made mistakes or not. So right now, I see we made no mistakes. We have 19 valid ROAs and 0 invalid ones, which is a good thing. After that, you need to install some validator software. Currently, we run two servers with different software. On one, we run the RIPE NCC's own RPKA validator. It was version 2, and a while ago, we switched to version 3 because, basically, it's Java, and it will eat all your memory, and version 3 doesn't eat as much as version 2, but still, you should put a lot of memory in that box. But it has a nice web interface where you can check all the ROAs, you can check what's happening, and also you can see, basically all the RPKA signed prefixes worldwide on the web interface. The second software we used is the Routinator 3000. That's from the fine folks at NL NetLabs. And that software is very, very memory efficient. It's very small, but it's written in Rust, which means you need the whole Rust toolchain, which for me, as a first timer, was a bit difficult to maintain, to say the least. But it's something you can learn, and nowadays it runs smoothly. And another thing, to get all that software, to get all the rowers, you need to fetch them from all the RIRs. That's not a problem for 4 of the 5 RIRs, and then there's Erin. Erin, the trust anchor of Erin, so their repository, their root CA, so to speak, is somehow special. And special, I mean special in a lawyery sense. Yeah? So they have a lot of lawyers, so it cannot be distributed with the software. You have to click like, no, I will not sue them, and I will not send my hitman over there and beat them to death if something goes wrong. And after you sign that, you can just download it and add it to your software, but you can't do it automatically. Actually, Routinator now has a switch on installation. It's like, okay, I agree to Erin, and then it will just download it in the background and install it. So it's like you're like signing it on your command line and like, yeah, yeah, no problem. But still, you have to be aware that if you just install it, you will run without the North American people. Yeah. After that, the last thing you have to do is configure routers. We currently use Juniper MX platform, which has the feature called origin validation for BGP, which is RPKI. And that's available a while now, since 12.2. I think it was presented, the first beta code was presented at a RIPE meeting somewhere in the past. And yeah, it's working, no problem. All of your peering routers, or all routers where you want to do RPKI validation, need a TCP session to the validator software. And on Juniper, you need to explicitly set the validation state in route policies. So it's like, you say, okay, if the route validator says it's invalid, then set the routing validation state to invalid. It's like you have to do that, tell it manually to do the thing it's supposed to do. And also in the route policy, or on the router, is the final step where you need to decide, do I want to just polish them somehow? So mark them, add a community, lower local pref, or do I just drop the invalid prefixes? If you're not dropping them, it's kind of debatable if you are getting something from RPKI. Because even if you lower local pref, if it's the only route you've got, you still got to use it. So the safe way is to drop the route, which is what we decided after a while. Why did we do it? First, because security is important to our customers. We have very, very security-conscious customers in our data centers. Secondly, it's good for the internet as a whole, which for me is always a good thing to do. And third, because we can. Nobody told us we couldn't, so we did. That's basically it. Also, probably it helped that all people I talked to probably didn't understand what I wanted to do anyway, so they just, yeah, go ahead, do it. So, yeah. And then came D-Day. On the last year in October at 10 a.m. in the morning, we activated our new routing filters and dropped our invalid prefixes. At that time, 5,000 invalid prefixes were dropped from the routing table, and 2,000 of those were not covered by a less specific prefix. Yeah, you have 3,000 prefixes were like covered by a valid larger prefix, but 2,000 had no other route. So 2,000 destinations dropped from our table at that day. Yeah, and after that, we said, okay, let's see what happens next. And it took a whole of 2 days after the next happened. After 2 days, the first report came in that a slash 22 went unreachable. We were contacted by a provider. I think it was a Russian provider who was like, yeah, we can you please check why our prefix can't reach your prefixes. Because it was a provider, it came directly to our network team, and we figured out quite soon that it was because of RPKI. And we told this to the provider, and 3 hours later, they had fixed their routers. So 3 hours later, the prefix went back to valid, and that was that. And it was like, okay, that's not too bad, is it? But this was only the first impact. So I will tell you what happened in the year after that. First, as a summary, there were difficulties because it turns out seeing that the problem you're having is RPKI related is not very obvious to most people. Many people don't know what RPKI is, or they don't know how it operates. If your customers are going to report it, they're not going to report you dropped an RPKI invalid prefix. They're like, DNS isn't working, or I can't reach that mail server, or somehow my API endpoint doesn't work anymore. So from the reports, it's not inherently clear that you did that by dropping an RPKI invalid prefix. So you need to be able to somehow collect these and be able to react it in the right way, which means tell people, hey, your prefix is invalid. Trace routes. We got trace routes from so many other providers, and everyone looks like we are black holing stuff, which essentially we are doing because you have no route back from us. But it's like the trace route goes through until the last hop, and after that came our network. So it's like blank. And like, yeah, you're dropping, you're black holing our traffic. And it's like, yeah, kind of, but not really, because we didn't do it. You did it yourself because you had an invalid prefix. Huh? And it's kind of difficult. Also, own trace routes, because believe it or not, we have people outside the network department who can do trace routes, and some of them even can interpret it the right way. So the trace route from our office ends after our office firewall, because then it goes to the core router, and he's like, I have no route drop. And it's like, oh god, the firewall is broken. Or like, so I don't understand what's going on. Or there were a lot of false interpretations in the beginning of what was happening, actually. So our firewalling team was involved a few times, like, and they're like, we are not filtering anything outgoing. So like, it's not us. And yeah, that's kind of difficult because it's really hard for people who are not working with this feature every day to identify that they are hit by the fallout from it. Also, the second part is when you're communicating with the other side, be it other providers or be it your customers. The support on the other side does not know RPKI most of the time. They don't know what's going on. Also, if you tell them what's going on, sometimes they don't even know how to contact. So who is able to log into the right portal and click on the right button to make it work again? It's very interesting how many ways there are to get to the right people, or how many ways there are to not get to the right people in another company. The second is, how do we inform the provider of the problem when their mail server is in the RPKI invalid prefix? That's like, yeah, okay, what do we do now? So going on IRC is like, has anyone a valid prefix to them and can send a mail for us? You know? So luckily, that only, I think, happened once or twice. But then you have to get creative, like going to another provider who is not filtering and sending a mail from there, which is not ideal. I get it. You know, I don't know. I mean, the good thing is, like, with a community like here, if you're in the community somewhere, you can find ways other than mail most of the time to get in contact with them. And the hardest thing sometimes was because the customer was like, yeah, but it works anywhere else. So you go to the customer, it's like, it's not our fault. It's like, everybody else doesn't have the problem, so it's obviously your fault. And then you have to explain why it really is not your fault, and even then the customer might disagree in the end. which is quite a problem if you are not able to communicate clearly what the problem is. What we learned from that is you need to have lessons for communicating. You have to brief your colleagues on RPKI, and with colleagues, I don't mean the networking colleagues especially, but also probably the wider support network in your company. Because people will see the fallout, and they are not in the networking team. They might be the mail admins, they might be the system admins. Everybody who uses the network, which surprisingly is probably everyone in the company, might be hit by this. In our case, I wrote a blog entry on our intranet to make people aware that we changed something. You have to weigh if that's good or not, because you also get reported like, that broke, and they're like, that's not that had nothing to do with what we changed. And like, yeah, it came at the same time. It has to be the same thing. And I, no, that's not really what happened. Yeah? You will get blamed for stuff that really doesn't have anything to do with RPKI, but I would say it's still worth it to inform people that you changed something. At least inform them a week after it. So that's like, hey, if you didn't notice anything until now, it's gonna be fine, isn't it? And you need templates for communicating with other parties, be it customers and providers. You have to explain what RPKI is, or at least point them at the Wikipedia entry. And if you want to be really sure, send them a link to where they can check the RPKI status themselves, so they can see, like, new prefix is invalid, or your provider's prefix is invalid. And I wanted to put it on a slide and forgot it. There are like two major tools that we use. One is the RIPSTAT website, because you can see the RPKI state on the RIPSTAT website. And there's like a Whois service from BGPmon, where you can do just a Whois for is this prefix valid or not, and we'll tell you if it is valid or not. Though if you send your provider or the other provider or your customer that and say, look, it's invalid, and if you fix it, this will change to valid, then my impression is they can, yeah, they grasp that it's not our fault in itself that the problem exists. And you, if you have a ticket system or something like that, you should search for missed cases, like cases where it's like something is unreachable, or I have a DNS problem, or I have a connectivity issue. That's like, yeah, you have to get creative to find tickets that probably didn't make it to you anyway. And people were like, something is not working, but didn't realize it had something to do with the network. Though that happened a few times also. So a few of these I collected myself and said, no, it's not a problem with the mail server, you can stop looking, it's a problem with the RPKI. Or with the other provider, not with the RPKI itself. RPKI itself is great. I want to show you a few funny individual cases, three of them. The first one is probably the biggest breakage that happened. This was when Unity Media Vodafone decided to make /16/17/19 invalid because they put out the wrong rower. I don't want to blame them. You know, it's like I saw so many people on so many failures in the beginning. It's a new system, okay? So I have they're good. I have no problem with them, but they caused like 3 separate custom reports in the first hour, I think in the first 30 minutes, where like, we can't reach you from Unity Media anymore. We can't reach you from Vodafone anymore. The problem was they announced their prefixes with the Liberty Global AS, but the rowers had Kabel WW Unity Media as origin in the rower. So there was an origin mismatch, and our router dropped the prefixes. The good thing is, we have connections to them. Yeah? In Germany, that's probably true for most providers. And again, after 3 hours, they were able to fix their rowers. And then our system picked it up and made the prefixes valid again. I think the most of the time, people react pretty quickly if you are able to reach the right people. I mean, 3 hours is not very long for fixing the rowers and pushing out the update. If they wouldn't have been so responsive, you would have to get creative, because then you have to weigh, is it more important to leave it running like that, or is it more important that your customer can reach you? So yeah, that's a bit of a trade-off you have to think about. The second case, the case of no exceptions, but maybe just one exception. We had a customer that was unable to reach an API endpoint. So yeah, no big deal. But that was detected on Thursday, and we informed the other provider. And then the customer informed us that they had planned a change on the weekend with 20 people, more than 20 people on standby, which was dependent on that API endpoint. And they couldn't do the change. And normally we don't do exceptions, because it takes the pressure off of the other provider to fix their rowers. So we're like, if it's not too important, we tell our customer, go to your provider and tell them they messed up, so they can fix it. It's not good if we put like 100 of exceptions in our software just to get around these broken providers. But in this case, sometime on Friday, the CEO was standing in the office and is like, how do we turn this RPKing off? And I was like, yeah, maybe we should do an exception first before turning it off completely. So we made an exception for that /24. The funny thing is, we made the exception, which is doable via the software. The RIPE NCC software can do it via the web interface. The Routinator software can do it on a JSON-like file you need to read in. The exception was put in place, and 45 minutes after that, the RAW was fixed by the provider. So it's like, well, then we put the exception out again after 45 minutes, and everything was fine. So yeah, but we really, exceptions was our the last resort we did, because we didn't want to just, because then we didn't have to do it anyway if we just made exceptions for everybody. And case three was the really strange case. A domain was unreachable because all name servers were in a /24 that was invalid. There was no reaction from the announcing IS or the IS in the rower. There was no reaction from the prefix owner. And the company in the prefix description, this was another company completely, didn't know the prefix at all. And we are like, so nobody knows anything about it? Is this a real hijack? Turns out that it probably wasn't, because I didn't hear back from them, but the RAW was fixed like a few days later. So it's like, but nobody said anything or nobody knew anything about the prefix. And I was like to our customer, are you sure you want to send mail to that company? Because no one seems to know anything about it. It's like, so are we really sure that's not a hijack? And he's like, I'm not so sure either. So we decided to leave it invalid and look what was happening. So yeah, I don't know. This was probably the strangest case I had, because really all the information was completely outdated or plainly wrong, or the people didn't know that it was their prefix. So it's like, okay, I have no idea what I should do now. Yeah, that was error in space, by the way. Yeah, all the lawyers didn't help by that to fix that. Yeah, that's the third case. In summary, we had only 13 known reports. I wouldn't rule out that we missed one or two, because it wasn't apparent that it was RPKI related. Three were reported by the affected providers themselves, and 10 were reported by customers of us. And the last report was in April 2019. So for the rest of the year now, we had no reports about something breaking, which is, I think, a good sign. Happy end. All reports were resolved in one way or another. 12 of the certain reports were fixed by the rowers being fixed. One just deleted all their rowers. But I saw they fixed it half a year later or so. So he's like, yeah, I fixed it. And we're like, yeah, you deleted your rower, but OK, whatever. Yeah. Most people fixed their rowers fast. So we had maximum of 10 days between report and fix, which I count as fast. And then we had others who just lost interest. We had providers. We're like, yeah, you have to fix this. And they're like, we are no longer talking to you. Like, okay. And we had customers where it's like, yeah, we can't reach that prefix. And I'm like, okay, have you contacted them? And they're like, yeah, yeah. And I wrote back like a few weeks later, and I'm like, is this still broken? And he's like, yeah, it's still broken. And I'm like, and it's okay? So yeah, it's okay. And I was like, okay, well, okay. Why not? If you don't need it, I'm fine. And customers, what I really found interesting is nobody yelled at us much for doing what we did. Our customers were very cooperative, which might be just our customers, but I hope it's yours too. If you explain them what RPKI is and why it is protecting them from leaking the information to third parties they probably wanted leaked to, or from hijacking. It takes a while, sometime, to explain to them what is happening, but if you explain to them what's going on, most of them were like, okay, we understand. Please, sometimes they're like, we are contacting our provider. Sometimes they say, can you please contact our provider, because you know what all the words mean, like RPKI, rowers, invalid, valid. We have no idea. Please do it, which we did. You can't leave your customer alone in that situation, because then they will complain to your sales or somewhere further up, and you will ruin your great thing you have. Yeah. Happy end part two, we are still filtering. So to this day, we are filtering invalids. It's getting better all the time. China Telecom had most of their prefixes invalid, and they fixed it somehow this year. I'm really impressed by that. They were like the biggest, I think the biggest block of invalid space, and nobody there cared for like a year. But now they are, they fixed it. And we are filtering, and you should do too. One thing is rather, from our standpoint, we don't want to be the only people being blamed if stuff breaks, because I don't want to hear it works everywhere else. I want to hear, yeah, it works nowhere. That's what I want to hear, because it's always bad if you're the only one doing the right thing and get blamed for it too. So please start filtering. I mean, big players are doing it. Cloudflare is starting it. Entity is doing it. Telia is starting it, I think, or has already started. So there are many of the bigger players starting to do the right thing now. Yeah, and with that, I think I'm through. If there are any questions, now is your time to shine. If someone wants to ask the question in German, no problem. I will translate it and answer in English. So feel free to ask in German or English as you like.
Okay. Before we get to questions, I want to do a quick show of hands. Who here has never heard of RPKI before DNOG? That is great. One. Who of you has or is already rejecting RPKI invalids?
Oh, nice.
Okay, that's quite a lot. Who's planning to do so in, let's say, the next 6 months? Good luck. And who's not planning to do so, just so we get... Okay, we have one. Okay, thanks for the show of hands. Then I'm up for questions. Please just raise your hand and wait for a mic.
Hi, Chris Cousins from Kentech. Did you consider detecting and notifying before filtering?
We detected beforehand, so we counted the prefixes. That where I got the 5,000 and 2,000 numbers from. Now we don't really have the manpower to notify the other providers of that. If they don't want to look at the available information, you can check if your prefix is valid or invalid. You know? I'm not sure if there is a project who actively notifies other providers. I'm not sure if there's a such a thing, but we didn't actually. We don't have hadn't the time for that.
Okay, other questions?
Yeah.
So you rejected about 5,000 prefixes last year. How did that develop? What's the number at now?
That's a good question. I should have looked it up. I think we still have, 2,000 or 3,000 invalid prefixes right now. But I can look it up and get back to you.
Natalie is nodding her head, so that should be around the number.
What happens when your Java or Rust engine with the validator software dies? Do you need a complete HA setup there, or doesn't it matter for an hour, or what happens?
So yeah, it doesn't matter for an hour exactly, because or at least you can configure it. Default is the router will cache the result for an hour. So you still have your prefixes invalid if your session dies for an hour or whatever you configure. And if one of your software systems dies, you still have the other one. I would say you should have probably two of them, just to be sure. Because, yeah, I mean, an hour seems like a long time, but if you're starting debugging Java, it can become very short very soon. So, yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. But you can configure it for a longer time if you want. But you have to live with longer invalid prefixes.
Okay, I'll run up to the next question. Just a quick reminder, please state your name and affiliation when asking a question.
Lutz Donhager for the record. When is the prefix re-evaluated for RPKI? Is it only evaluated if it comes to a peering, or if it's re-evaluated if, I don't know. signature is timed out or something like this?
So the validator software, we will reevaluate it. And if there are changes like switches from valid to invalid or something else, it will push the chains to the router, and the router will then, or at least the Juniper router does it, will then reevaluate all prefixes to see if it changed. So it will drop new invalid prefixes right then, and it will make other prefixes valid again. So it's like whenever there's a change that the validator software reports to the router, it will reevaluate all the prefixes, be it filtered or not. So it happens automatically. And also I have to say, I didn't mention that we filter only now on upstream sessions and peering sessions, not our customers, because we have manual strict filtering for our customers. And we don't trust our customers right now to do the right API stuff. So we're only filtering the bigger guys. Yeah.
One question from my end, Theo and Nexia. Yeah. Did you observe also the traffic levels at the time where you dropped the prefixes?
Yeah, I wanted it too. No. Nothing we could detect. It was like, it wasn't. The thing is, we are not a very high traffic network as such. We have mostly business customers, and most of our traffic is like mail and stuff and web. And we didn't detect any significant change in traffic levels. If that had happened, we would have looked very closely what was happening. But no change in traffic levels. Yeah.
Okay, then I will also take the mic to ask a question, Moritz from Data Center One. We luckily only had one RPKI-related incident yet, but we were kind of struggling on the communication, and I was wondering if you are aware of any, I don't know, RPKI.wtf site where you can just send a link and tell people to look at, so we all don't have to reinvent the wheel when talking about to someone about RPKI mishaps.
So, yeah, I think we sent for explanation reasons, we sent like a small text what RPKI is and the link to the Wikipedia, and then we sent just the link to the prefix in the RIPE.stat page and the whois output from the whoisbgpmon.net. So that's the two tools we use. I'm not aware of some like a site where you just have a big smiley if everything is right or not. Would probably be nice to have something like that, like the where you can check your own prefix. But yeah, I'm not aware of any such tooling. Oh, I thought you had a question yourself, Theo.
No.
Okay.
Leonard Wagner from NTT Germany. I think Job Snyder's had helped to develop a tool you can find on the RIPE.net website to check RPKI with a smiley or some other.
But I think that's only for the RPK for the prefix you are currently in. If that's not the case, okay. I only used it for like is my current network filtering RPKI. That's the thing the tool does with the smiley face. I'm not sure if you can check any prefix.
It's possible. It's only for the prefix you're in.
Okay, that I didn't know, but I just wanted to mention.
Okay. That's a good good thing anyway.
Yeah. That tool. Thank you.
Yep.
But check out that site and see the smiley because our network is dropping RPKI invalids.
Yes, it is.
Further questions? All right, then. Thank you very much, Sebastian.
Thank you very much.